open your mouth and tell God something real nice tonight. Come on, tell him you appreciate him. Tell him you love him. Come on, come on, all across the sanctuary. Tell him how much he means to you. Simple song. It goes like this.
My hallelujah belongs to you. 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 You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. My hallelujah belongs.
Come on, y'all got it. Come on, say, my hallelujah. From the bottom of your heart, lift your voice. My hallelujah. Lord, my hallelujah. Yeah. Then we simply say, you deserve it. Real simple, say it, church.
You deserve it,
Lord. You deserve it, Lord. Yeah.
You deserve it, Lord.
Now say, all of the glory. Yeah.
All of the glory belongs to you.
Everything I give you, Lord. Everything I owe you, Lord, it belongs to you.
All of the glory belongs to you.
Y'all got it now? Come on, say it. All of the glory, the tear rolling down my face. When I'm on bended knees, I say, oh Lord, you deserve it.
But who wanna might look ahead and say, hallelujah,
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 hallelujah, all the glory,
all the glory,
and all the honor,
all the honor,
and all the praise.
All the praise.
You deserve. Can we lift our hands together one time?
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Everybody, come on in concert and say it.
Yeah. Great. Good to have us, everybody. We're way in Australia. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. So it's good, everybody, to say hello and greetings. It's a pleasure to be back with you. It's Monday evening, and we just want to take time out to bless the Lord. We will continue our discourse in the book of Romans. And at the end of this, we're going to have you join us in prayer. So welcome, everybody that's here with us online, and stick around with us. And if you're on Facebook or log in there, then make sure that you share. Sorry about that. You share the word of God, because it's very important this year that we focus our hearts on the righteousness of God and the love of God. And what comes to us is what we call life, prosperity, and honor. So if you stop with me for a minute, we're going to take time out to begin in prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we're just grateful to you for your sustenance, for your keeping, for your care over your people's lives. We thank you that you are God, and more so our Father. We thank you for Jesus, that you have given in full pardon of our sins, and that sin has no more dominion over us because of the grace that has been bestowed on our lives. Thank you for your people who are here tonight, those who are here early, those who will come on late, and whatever medium they're viewing us on and participating in this time of devotion. We pray, Holy Spirit, that your own presence will be with us. And let this be an experience that edifies your children. It is for that reason you came into the world. And so, Father, the very reason of bringing salvation to humans. Thank you for your word tonight and your people. In Jesus' mighty and precious name. Amen. All right. Once again, we're back there, believers, at Romans chapter 5. We began last week. We spoke about Martin Luther in the 1500s, that he could not proceed in the becoming part of the then Catholic Church. And what came to be known as the Reformation had now been declared, because he could not subscribe to the church forgiving people or justifying people. He believed that is an expression of faith in Christ Jesus. And it is from there that we had a major division in the Catholic Church. And so we end up with what you could call the Reformed Church or the Lutheran Church or all these different type of descriptions that we do have today. Now, was he crazy or was he off his rockers? No. Actually, what he was wrestling with is this book of Romans and the writings here from chapter 5. And listen, verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Very explicit and very clear. But in the times of Martin Luther and the days prior to then, there's a false doctrine that developed in the then church that it is the act of the priest of the Catholic Church or the Papa or Pope that granted absolution, that gives you freedom from sin. And by listening to your confession in the confession window, an assigned to you task, your sins would be considered mediated, or your sins would be considered gone. Not true, my friends. Those are false hope. Amen. And if you have Catholic brothers and sisters, those are the things that you have to discuss with them, how sins are forgiven. They also, the Catholic Church also advanced a theory that you can go to purgatory. So if you committed sins after you became a member or you joined the Catholic Church and you died, but you were not really good, per se, using my words, then you would go to purgatory. When you are in purgatory, those who are alive, like your family members, would continue to give offering and property and whatever else, or they would pray at church and make the signs of the cross or pray Holy Marys. And depending on how pious or consistent your family members are, then they would literally pray you out of purgatory. Purgatory takes its name from purgation, means a place where you are cleansed, a place where you are washed. We really don't know where that is, except that it's called purgatory. And it means that it's a sort of state prior to you getting into the presence of God. You got to pass through purgatory. Now, I will tell you that it is while you're alive, you must be purged. The psalmist David prayed, and he prayed to be purged with hyssop. Later on, we understand in the writing of John that we are, and Paul, that we're purged from our sins. We're purged from the old nature. We're washed and cleansed by the blood of Jesus. And then there's also limbo. And in the Catholic theology, and if you have children that are not mentally, have mental abilities to make their decisions, those who are bothered by whether it be trisomy 21 or some other disease issue, that they have mental deficiencies, then they would not really be sent to hell or something. They would go to limbo. This is a place for those who are not well, and they would be taken care of here, a place for children. So there are all these things that are being made up. And so people became adherents to the faith because it provided a sort of physical escape. And people like, especially those who are wealthy, they like to contribute to their salvation. And we tend to want to do that sometimes. We might be heard because we gave a good offering. We might satisfy God because he's pleased with our gifts and all this type of thing. However, what we're coming to the understanding of righteousness here, your gifts are essential in telling us where your heart is, but your gifts do not cleanse you. Your gifts do not grant you absolution. Your gifts do not grant you freedom. They do not expiate or wash away or purge your sins. And this, the real thing that we want to advance in the hearts of God's people, as we said in chapter 3 of the text, there is no one righteous, not even one. That is the beginning state. When we come to the Lord Jesus now, that is not your position anymore. You are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. So the Christian can't walk around saying there's no one righteous. That was the prior state prior to us coming to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. When you come to Christ Jesus in full faith and acknowledgement that his blood saved you from your sins, then you are now considered the righteousness of God. Now, that's very important to remember. So, Catholic had this major rift, it was never healed. Since that time, we have had, literally an evangelical side and a Catholic side to the church, if you want to look at broad designations there. Now, let's return to Romans 5. So, I want to take the first five verses tonight and leave it right there. So number one, we are justified by our confidence in the finished work of Jesus Christ. The Bible said justified. Remember that word. Every time you see it, it means that God declares you. You're not righteous by your doing or your own achievement. It's a declaration of God that is based on what you believe. Now, you can't just believe anything to be justified. You got to believe what God says you ought to believe, and that is, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. So, faith is not just a word we throw around. I have faith. No, your faith has to be anchored in the person of Jesus Christ. So when you're saying, I have faith in Christ Jesus, I have faith in the Almighty God and his power to do A, B, C, D, E, F, G, that type of thing. Now, so let's continue to look at this. So we're justified. Come on with me, everybody. Being justified means I'm declared righteous before God. I'm declared righteous, which means God wants me to be in right relationship with him. And so my responsibility is to put my faith in his son and my savior, Jesus Christ. Now, that sounds so simple that many people don't believe it. You know, we still believe there must be some action that I have to perform. Now, well, faith will ultimately have some form of action. But the real thing is that it must be a solid conviction in your heart that Jesus is Savior. I want you to look, because we're going to talk about that in Romans 10, 9 and 10 shortly. When we get there, listen what it says here, and I want to bear this in mind very carefully. It says, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God, now notice these words, believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Watch this. For it is with your heart that you believe, not just your mind here, not just your thinking here. It has to be with thinking, but it also has to do with your desire, has to do with a decision making, has to be with choice. And it has a passion to it. That is why we talk about repentance, because that happens in the soul. Now, we're going to discuss that when we get there. But I just want to tell you verse 10 in Romans 10. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified. Notice this. Is the heart you believe, and then you're declared righteous. And with your mouth, you confess and are saved. So it's very important. The scripture is consistent as to how we gain appropriate benefit from righteousness. Praise God. Now, let's run down a little more here. Then the scripture explains in verse 2, it is by Jesus and through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace. Now, so let's break that down slowly. It is through him, Christ Jesus, that we have gained access. Now, like you said, Jesus said, I am the way, I am the door. By me, if anyone enters, he or she shall be saved. So Jesus is your access point into dwelling in God. Jesus is your access, my access, but you don't pay a visit or a vacation or we're getting a flight up to New York and you just fly for 3 hours and you land and that's it. You get out the plane and it's over. No, when the Bible talks about we gained access, it is a permanent access we're talking about here, permanent access. So Jesus becomes the door by which we enter into the life of God. Very important. You enter into the life of God. We ain't coming out, people of God. Amen. And the Bible said, notice the word faith is cropping up again. That is your confidence in Christ Jesus. And he said, you gain access. How do you get it? Through faith. So right now, you're in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, and you believe in him. Wherever Jesus is, that's where you are, because he's your door. So he doesn't just leave you on earth without any hope. wherever that door is, that's where you are. Praise God. Very reassuring tonight. Amen. Now, he talks about entering this grace, and that grace, we talk about the charis of God, and it gives a sense of God's kindness, God's love, God's favor towards us, a favor that we do not merit. In other words, you don't perform meritorious acts, you know, the works of charity to gain the favor of God. God grants us favor because he is a good God. He's a gracious God. That's who he is. That's the description of his character. And so God is good to his people. And it is in that grace that you're sustained. It is in that grace that you stand. And that word means a lot because it is implying that your life is rooted in that grace. That is the unmerited favor and the kindness of God. Now, verse number 3, we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Or rather, that's the ending of verse number 2. So the idea there, we not only have access into God's grace, but within this, we now have hope. So there's not a sense of depression and hopelessness and sadness as a result of one being declared righteous. What has happened? God has lifted that from our lives. Very important. So if you look at this, when sin and ungodliness is in our lives, we are really oppressed. What really happens now, subsequent to us being declared righteous? It's like, all right, let's say that you're charged with a criminal act. You get to court and you are charged $10,000 and you only have $10 or you have $0. In other words, you are unable to pay your debt. Now, what happens? Somebody shows up that you don't even know who this person is, and they just consented to pay your $10,000. See, the judge had told you $10,000 or 5 years in jail, let's say that. Now, you were looking at jail time because you did not have $10,000. But then you could say a good Samaritan showed up, paid your $10,000. And he not only did that for you, he turned around and put you in his car and drove you home. And when you thought that it was his car, you got out and he got out and he handed you the key and you realize your debt of $10,000 to the legal system was not only paid, but now you got chauffeur driven home and the very car that drove you home belonged to you. That's grace. You see, you could look at the first act that happened in the courthouse as an act of mercy. But now you are a convicted criminal, but here is somebody pouring out on you. And so what does this do? It fills you with joy because you do not deserve any of this. So that is the sort of background to which the Holy Spirit is directing us, that we're like criminals, we're spiritual criminals. We've been found guilty by the judge of the universe. Our behaviors have been awful. And a gracious God shows up, offers us his son. And then his son gave his life, the Bible says, as a price paid, a ransom for you and I. And then he said, now what you do to be relieved is to believe on my son that I sent. And I will consider that enough to grant you absolution, forgiveness. I will set you free from all your sins. And so that is why the scripture then says we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. In other words, what we're seeing in this grace of God is God's glory. The word is doxa. And what it implies is this, that all of this kindness, all of this goodness, all of this wealth, all of this, God is showering down on us. Praise God. And so it's called the glory of God. The glory of God is consistently an expression of the full repertoire of God's goodness, God's wealth and riches towards his children. And one of the most glorious ways in which God's wealth is distributed to his children is through his grace. Number one in his grace is the redemptive grace. Number two, the giving of the Holy Spirit. Number three, the care and the nourishment of your lives, eternal life. All these form the glory of God, the riches of his supply in your life and mine. And so the Bible says to us that we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. That's why the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. That's the difference. One brings you down to depression and death and sadness and frustration. The other one raises you into life. That's what gives us rejoicing. Verse number three, our rejoicing continues. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings. Now, this is difficult for many believers. Because when we are suffering, we get really obnoxious. When we are suffering, we can become hateful. We can become angry. We can become vicious. But for the children of God, we got to then look carefully as to what we're dealing with here. Because the Bible says we rejoice in our sufferings. And that word is the word that also in the King James is called tribulation. It's when you're hard pressed. It's when you're stressed out. When life is pressing you down like an olive. When you're being roasted in the fire like a piece of gold or silver. Notice how it works. Not trash. For the ungodly are like trash, and the trash gets burnt up. You can't go through fire. Fire tests the substance of your life. Fire is a way to evaluate the substance of your life. That's what the stress does or the suffering does. It's evaluating your life. It's helping you to see the substance of your life. If you throw in the towel and give up, we know the substance. If you cuss and swear, we know the substance. You see, when trial comes, how do you bear up under this? The indwelling Holy Spirit facilitates your ability to stand up under trials. Now, oh, praise God. But we also rejoice in our suffering. So we not only rejoice in the grace of God in which we stand, but we also rejoice in sufferings. Why? Because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Now, you got to look at that, my friends, because the idea there is giving us the sense of our patience. It's given a sense of our stick-to-itiveness, if we use a current day thing, in which we're saying, I refuse to be frustrated. You know, why? Because of what happened before. I'm declared righteous. In other words, my life, remember, righteousness produces life, prosperity, and honor. You gotta remember that, believers. Proverbs 21:21. And this is what is being emphasized now in the New Testament. This very text is now covering, is what we are covering here. Now, I think I was saying on Sunday to the believers that there are times when we believe that we're going to be cut short because there's suffering. We're going to be short. No. Actually, it is more evident during times of hardship, and you are doing well. We said that in 3 John 2, when the Apostle Paul said, I wish above all things that you will prosper and be in good health, even as your soul prospers. When do you see this? In times of difficulty, it is okay to note prosperity. It's very visible at that time, believers. So then, we rejoice in suffering, in tribulation, in painful situations, in disappointing situations, in times of sickness and mental oppression and all type of things. Because whenever we are pressed this way, we are developing the fruit of patience or perseverance. All right? Now, perseverance, when we are persevering, it means that we're not giving up. It means that you're pressing through. So look what perseverance does. Because you refuse to give up and you're pressing through, perseverance now results in the construction of divine character. That is, you are now having a disposition that God wants in you as his righteous one. Now, you will see that in the life of Jesus. See, there's no name calling. There is no diminish him. There is no threat to him, not even at the cross or any place that he would back off. He would persevere. He would press through. On the final night, heading into the passion, while he was in the garden, the Bible said he persevered in prayer. He prayed. He was pressed till his sweat became like drops of blood. What was it talking to? It was speaking to his character. Most of the times when we're going through the fire, we're going through hardship, we can become bitter. And if that is the case, my friends, then we can't give ourselves any stupid story. We have to back up and recognize here that we are failing of the grace of God. The grace of God was never given to you to be bitter. On your worst day, on the day of your persecution, on the day when you're put down, on the day when you're trampled on, no bitterness. God cannot approve this. And so I want us to bear that in mind, that that will produce what we say, patience. Patience grant lots of experience, because we are passing through life. So you like to hear pastors say, I'm 62, which means I've had a lot of experiences. And those experiences help to shape character. Amen. Now, there are times when the negative experiences, if you do not have righteousness as the foundation of your life, you will become a bitter, angry, insulting, selfish person. That will be your character. Those will be your characteristics. But if you are the child of God who recognizes what God has placed in you, those things won't give way to bitterness and anger and malice and strife and all that. No, because those are the things that righteousness came to destroy. So there are times when we really have to go to God and we got to repent, because we have somehow renounced his righteousness and we're tackling things by ourselves, and it is ending up with the fruit of ungodliness. Now, whenever we have the character of God is then constructed within us, our hope, praise God. Now, this is important, because hope is essential for your life. Don't ever get to the part of hopelessness and think it's okay, you'll bounce back. No, you have to be very acute. You have to be very sensitive that you do not fall into hopelessness. And how does this happen? It happens when we start to criticize the wisdom of God. It happens when we are not trusting the word of God. It happens when we start to rationalize and lie. Because that's how Satan introduces himself. So after a while, we become sad and despondent to the point where we lose hope. Watch this. When God advances or declares you righteous, it is a statement that is being made into your spirit that you're accepted in the beloved. God loves you. Praise God forevermore. Now, hope does not bring disappointment. Why? Because God's love has been poured out. Thank you. Now, we see that because that is the word agape, or it's very essential here because this is a love in practice. Agape is a love in practice. This is not a mental thing where we're going around saying we love people, but it's only mental. We can't forgive them. We harbor bitterness and wrath and malice against them, but we're saying we love them. The agape of God, which the believers should possess, is a love of action. Actually, in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, when we talk about the agape of God, the Bible refers, the King James interpreted it with the word charity, because it implies action. So when we go on missions, it's charitable service. Actually, the church is labeled in our constitution, or our laws and land, as a charitable organization. And that is the same word for love. These are organizations of love. But what we have done, brothers and sisters, so this is how the Bible talks about this charity. It suffers long, is kind, envies not, does not get puffed up, or does not behave itself unseemly, seek it not our own, is not easily provoked, does not think evil. Look at what it does. Rejoices in iniquity. Now, that's what I'm saying. When the love of God is in your heart, even when you are hard-pressed, you have a level of rejoicing, because your hope is not in those things, not in the suffering of those things. It bears all things, believe all things, hope all things, and endures all things. So you'll find all of these things. We're talking about faith and hope, and all these things lie in the fact of those who love. So let's try to wrap this up and see what goes on here. In verse 5, it says, hope does not disappoint us because God has poured out his love in our hearts by the Holy Spirit whom he has given to us. Now, so it's supernatural love that we possess, the love of God. That is the, you see now how we are wrapping together the ideal of righteousness, being declared righteous and having the love of God. Why? You're going to have great hope in Almighty God, not in your country, not in your money, not in your children, not in your church, not in your pastor. You're going to hope thou in God, for I shall yet praise him, who is the help of my countenance and my God. Amen. So, believers, you know, we are apt sometimes to make the mistake, and we get very disappointed when our hope is in a person. You know, can't do that. Can't do that. You know, there's a level to which we have to trust people, but the finality of your hope cannot be in a person, can't be in a parent. They die tomorrow. What will happen to your hope? You know, can't do these type of things. You see, your hope will not disappoint because God pours out his love in your heart. And remember what we're talking about when we speak about this, because we say that when you have gone through suffering, you develop patience, and patience will produce character. And ultimately, because of this godly character, you will possess hope. In other words, you become an optimistic person. Why? Because righteousness produces certain, and you believe it, and you have expectation to receive the benefits of righteousness. Now, anytime, believers, we stay away from the benefits of righteousness, then what happens? You lose hope. If the benefits of righteousness, as we said before, life, prosperity, honor. And you renounce righteousness and you choose to go it by yourself or do it by yourself. What are you renouncing? Life, prosperity, and honor. See, it is then you're going to be disappointed, dejected. It is then you're going to be depressed, because what God offers through righteousness, you have renounced. There is great peace and joy for the believer, but the avenue, the way towards this is God's righteousness and God's love that is poured out in your hearts. This year, we need to pursue this with all our being, praise God. Because in this, your soul will return to life, because you will experience peace and joy. You were created for peace and joy, not for sadness, not for anxiety, living states of trepidation and misery and mental pain and anguish. That wasn't the calling of God. You were meant to have peace and joy. Being justified by faith, I have peace. Praise God. The love of God shed abroad in my heart grants me hopefulness. That's great joy, my friends. Now, so the Bible tells me I can rejoice in this hope because of the glorious provisions of our God. Peace and joy is yours, no matter what's going on around you. There is an inner sense of calm and satisfaction and expectation from God, and we live with that optimism, and there's no fear in your life because your confidence is in the living God. Hallelujah. Oh, believers, I just want to thank you for being there tonight and joining us in this great time of devotion. I want to thank God that he has empowered you and give me an opportunity to join us. We're going to just run down our list of prayers. I'm going to take, our people are on Zoom, and I'm just going to start at the top according to the names I'm seeing on my list there. So, hello, Lisa. I think you're there. So you got to start out followed by Drew, followed by Mona, followed by Santa, followed by Paulette. The toilet right there. So turn your phone on and hello, Lise, and pray for us tonight.
Hello, Pastor. Good night, everyone. One second. Heavenly Father, we come to you tonight asking for your blessings and help as we gather here tonight. As we gather here tonight on Zoom and Facebook, we pray for your guidance. We pray for your strength, knowledge, and wisdom. We pray for our health. We pray for our pastor and Sister Grant's health. We pray for our friends and family's health. Lord, we pray for our eyes to be open to the truth of the scriptures. Lord, let us walk in the path of your word, righteousness. Please bless us tonight as we meditate on your words. Lord, we give you thanks. We give you praise. You are great. You are wonderful. We glorify you. We worship you. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Amen.
Praise God. Amen. Praise his name.
Father, we just give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. We thank you, Father, for your servant. We thank you for opening up our hearts to understand what it is, oh God, that you're speaking to us at this time in our nation and even in our church and in our individual lives, that righteousness and love is, it comes from you. And it is the truth that we ought to walk in as your children, and we ought to do everything within our ability to obtain, to maintain righteousness and to walk in love and to show it, demonstrate love, not just to our brothers and sisters, but also to our family and to our communities. Father, we pray right now that some of our hearts, there's so many things going on. There's so many distresses around us. And like your servant is saying, sometimes we experience frustration and we experience bitterness and we experience anger and rebellion and resentment and all of these things, Father. Do not bring us to a place where we're walking in righteousness and in obedience and we're not walking in love. So, Father, each and every one of us, we present our hearts before you tonight. And we ask you, like the psalmist David said, to search our hearts, O God. Know our thoughts, we pray. See if there is wickedness in us. See if there's bitterness in us. See if there's anger, there's resentment. Sometimes there's depression and all different types of stresses that causes us to turn away from your truth. See these iniquities in us, O God, and cleanse our hearts, O God. Purify our thoughts and teach us the way of our Lord Jesus Christ. Teach us to walk in love, a love that is patient, a love that is kind, a love that suffers long, a love that is not boastful or prideful, a love that is forgiven. So, Father, may you, O God, through your own divine power that is at work in our lives and through your word that we have received tonight. And there's some, Father, that will be listening later on, even on Facebook. We ask you, Father, that you, Lord God, will cause the hearts of all the persons that will hear you to open up, O God, and to be transformed to the truth of your word that has been presented here tonight. Lead us and continue to guide us, Father. Holy Spirit of the living God, we thank you for your sanctifying power that is at work, because it is you that is able to cleanse us and purify us from all unrighteousness and to bring us into a place of holiness, because we are told in your word, mighty God, that without holiness, it is impossible to please you. We cannot live in you and move in you without you being changing and transforming and conforming us to your holiness and righteousness. So we take on the righteousness of our Lord Jesus Christ right now. We take on the truth of the words that has been presented here tonight from the word of God, the undiluted word of God. And we declare tonight that we will walk in love, that we will walk in holiness, that we will walk in righteousness, that we will be patient and we will be kind. We will be gentle. We will suffer long with each other. We will look out for each other. We begin to walk, oh God, in the fullness of who we are to represent on the planet as your light that is now shining in the dark places of our planet. You have presented us, Father, at a time as this, so that we will represent you in these dark days, Fathers, so that the light that you have poured within us will overshadow the darkness that is around us and our families. So, Father, may the power of your presence permeate all of our being so that we could reflect the true light of our Lord Jesus Christ in all his fullness, because it in Christ Jesus dwelleth the fullness of the Godhead. So, Father, we pray that the eyes of our hearts will be enlightened to these truths, that we will know and understand the hope to which you have called us. We will know the riches of your glorious inheritance in us. We will experience the greatness of your power towards us, because we are yours. We are called by your name. And even as we looked at Psalms 91, that says, because we have set our love upon you, we know you, and then we could call upon you, you will answer, that you will be with us in trouble, that you will honor us, that you will satisfy us with long life and show us your saving power. Father, we pray that we'll continue to walk in these truths. To you we ascribe all glory, honor, praise, dominion, and majesty. In Jesus' name, amen.
Ms. Mona, I think you're next. Father Blake.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Father God, we give you praise, Lord. We give you thanks, Father God. We thank you for who you are, Lord. We thank you, Jesus, for your, we thank you, Jesus, for who you are. We thank you for your righteousness, holiness, Lord. Father God, we give you praise, we give you honor, and we glorify you, Lord. Father, we thank you for your word tonight, Father God, that you have, that your manservant had brought forth, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you would continue to bless Pastor and his family, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the word that came through, Lord. We would not be doers, Lord, but we would act, we would practice your word, Lord. That we would be, we would do doers of your word, not just hearers, Father, Lord. And we thank you, Jesus, for your word, Lord. We thank you for you are a righteous Father, Lord. God, we give you praise for who you are, Lord. We thank you, Jesus, once again, Lord, for all those, Lord, who are with us today, Lord. We thank you for family, Lord. We thank you for health, Lord. And those who are not well, Lord, we ask that you would just heal them, Father, Lord. That you would continue, Father, Lord, your blessing, Lord, and your healing. Again, in Jesus' name, amen.
Praise God, amen. Santa. Santa, are you there, son?
Yes, sir. Father God, we thank you for your grace. We thank you, Father God, for your awesome hand on us. Father God, we thank you for yet another year. Father God, we thank you for your choice of leadership. Father God, I thank you for what you're doing. I thank you for your will, Father God, as I heard somebody say, nothing more and nothing less. Father God, my prayer goes out for the leaders of my city, Bill de Blasio. My prayer goes out for the leader of my state, Cuomo, and all the senators who are going to be making laws and rules which could make hurt me. Father God, I pray that my Lord God, you will be gathering Daniels around these leaders. Father God, I pray that you will be gathering Josephs around these leaders. My Lord, we thank you for such a time as this. Father God, I still don't desire to be in anywhere else. I still don't desire to be in any other dispensation other than this here. I thank you for what I see you doing. My family, thank you for what we see you doing, Father God. You have not left we, Lord Jesus. Through all this, Father God, you are with us. You are with us. And we thank you, Jesus, for what we are seeing you doing. Though we don't, for the most part, don't quite get it. But it is apparently we are living your will. And we thank you. We thank you, Father God, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Praise God. Amen. Sister Paulette. Amen.
Father, we want to thank you again for tonight, Lord. We thank you for this opportunity that we can come before you, Father, and to study your word. Lord, we are so thankful that when you save us, you make us to be a peculiar set of people, one that is set apart, Lord, that we can come to you at any time. We have this access to Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you for your son that, Lord, he has opened the door that we can able to come into your kingdom and to worship your Father. Lord, we thank you for your righteousness, that you're a righteous God. You are faithful morning and evening towards us. Your mercies are ever great. Lord, we thank you that we can trust you and that we can depend on you, Father. We thank you tonight, Father, for your word, because we know that your word is true. And no, Father, without your word, Lord, we would know what would have happened to us. But we thank you that we can live by your word and it guides us into all truth. Lord, it gives us life, is food for our soul. And we just want to thank you tonight, Lord, for your righteousness. We thank you that we can rejoice in you. Lord, we thank you Lord, that when we suffer, our tribulation comes upon us, we don't have to worry because we know in whom we trust and in whom we believe, that you are dear for us. We can stand on your promises. Lord, you said, Father, that you are our refuge. You said that you are our fortress and we can have confidence and faith in you. Lord, we just thank you tonight, Father, for your word. We thank you for our pastor, Lord, as he dedicates his heart to be obedient to your word, Lord, to teach your children so that we can able to grow in you and glow in you, Father. Because, Father, without your word, we would be nothing. But we thank you, Father, for you said, how can we learn without a teacher? And we thank you, God, that he teaches your word, that we can able to grow in you, Father, that we can able to be strong in you, that we can able to be bold in you. That's when Satan comes around in cheap clothing, we'll able to know them. Lord, we pray, God, that thou will let our hearts be close to you at all times, to walk as children of light. Lord, you said we should be the salt of the earth, and if we should lose our flavor, would good for nothing. Help us, Lord, that we'll not lose our flavor at no time, but we will be bold, we'll be children of light. Dear Father, we pray, God, that thou will help us to walk into your righteousness, Lord. Let your righteousness fill our hearts, fill our family's heart, Father. Fill our church. Lord, let us love one another. As you said, we should love one another. Not just lip service, but to show the love and the kindness, Lord, to do your work. Oh, Father, we just want to thank you tonight, Lord. We thank you for each and every brethren that, Father, even though we are far apart, yet we are near in heart. And we pray that thou will bind us together, Lord. And let us be a strong link which cannot be broken. Lord, we thank you for your Holy Spirit tonight. We thank you for your holy anointing. Lord, we pray that thou will bless us. And as we humble wait upon you, we say thanks in Jesus' name.
Praise God. Thank you, one and all. It's great that you join us tomorrow night. Please be there to join us and log in on time and get your friends and enemies and everybody else. It's a year of righteousness and love. And get everybody online. We gotta get somewhere here with the word of God. So please get everybody logged in for Bible study. We're still in Romans chapter 5. It's a sort of linchpin in the book, and we just want to amen explore that some more tomorrow night. So let's get ready for that, everybody, and help each other, call each other, talk to each other. Then on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, we're having fasting in the day. And in the evening, you can break it with some light things. So we have a three-day fast that will land us as we complete the year. And we're really fasting that our people will be fulfilling the responsibility of the righteousness of God. And the love of God, we are fasting that happens in our nation, our churches. Righteousness will once again flow down. Amen. Very important. Flow down and bring revival to our nation and our church. So that's where we are, everybody. So we come together tomorrow and we continue to study. So we'll take your closing benediction at this time. Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift his awesome countenance upon you. The Lord grants you peace. Have a great Amen. Night. And we'll be together again tomorrow. If the Lord sticks around, we shall be meeting tomorrow night at 8 p.m. God bless you. Keep filling out your paperwork. Everybody should have it if you're near or far. Even Santo is in New York. There is the paperwork for your ministry functioning this year. And once we get it, hopefully we can get everybody by this week. We'll start to collate all of this and start to function even when we are on social media, we're going to start functioning. The Church of the Lord Jesus Christ must go on. God bless you, everybody. Have a good night. Love you out there, everybody, and wherever you are on Facebook or Zoom. God bless you.
No, he's the one. No, sorry, nobody can go by church.
Like a cross on
that's the man house.